congratulations on K3 success.
Thank you very much for the for having me here, for inviting me. Can you hear me well? Okay, so I will start by maybe the most important part of the talk, which is that this is joint work, which I always forget, with Alice Garbagnati from Milano. Okay, so let me tell you what we are gonna do for the next 50 minutes. So a little outline of the talk. We're gonna do the following. So first, I will spend the first 5 minutes just to let you know what we want to speak about. So first, I'm gonna make a small, an introduction where I'm gonna define the main things that I will work with. So I will define what is a K3 surface and what is an elliptic vibration. And in the second part of the talk, I'm gonna tell you about what we want to do with these things, so our problem, our main problem. And finally, the method, which is somehow in the same section maybe, that we use to deal with this. So let's start with the first thing, which is what is a K3 surface? So a K3 surface for me, this doesn't always have to be, it's gonna be an algebraic surface. So it's a smooth algebraic, smooth projective, and I'm gonna be looking at it over C. This also does not have to be. Actually, many things that I do will hold over any field K, but just for safety, because there are some things that I use that hold for C and that we do not know yet if they are known for any field K. So what is a K3 surface? A K3 surface, say X, is a yes, many things will hold for any field, but there will be some things that I have to use that have been done by others and that we just don't know yet if they hold for any field. So a K3 surface, it's a smooth projective surface such that it has trivial canonical bundle. So it has trivial canonical bundle. So for us, I'm simply gonna say Kx is trivial. And it's a regular surface. And this means that something that we normally call Q, the irregularity, is zero. So that's the kind of surfaces that we're gonna be looking at. Maybe this doesn't tell you anything about them, because maybe you don't know what these things mean. Let me give you one example or two so that you have a feeling of what these things are. So, for example, something that you probably all are familiar with, a quartic surface in P3. So this is a K3 surface. So the points that satisfy this equation give you a K3 surface. So a quartic in P3 is a standard example. Another one, well, there are several, is, for example, you can look at P2. Well, this is not a K3 surface, but you can consider the double cover of it, which is branched over a degree 6 curve. So this is also a K3 surface. Over a sextic. So this sextic, if it's a smooth sextic, everything okay. If it's not smooth, maybe you have to blow up then the points that are singular in that sextic to get to your K3. So I hope that this makes you feel a little better with the surfaces in case you never saw them before. So now let me give you the second definition of the talk, which is an elliptic vibration, and normally I'm going to be looking at them on a surface, okay? So I have y, a surface, so an elliptic vibration. So that was K3 surface, now an elliptic vibration on, say, a surface y. Again, smooth, nice surface in the sense of Poonen, for example. Say y is for a surface such that, first of all, it's going to come with a map P, or I, if you like, to a base B, which for me it's also a smooth projective curve, such that for almost all points, well, so for all but finitely many points T in the base, so here I'm assuming I am over C, so I don't put the field, we have that pi minus 1 of T is a curve of genus 1. Okay, yeah, it's a smooth curve of genus 1. And there are two more things that I might want to ask during this talk. So this would be just like an elliptic vibration. And there are two more things that we might want to ask, and they are the following. So first, I might want to have it relatively minimal to respect to the, so 2 pi. So this means that the fibers of the vibration do not have minus 1 curves as a component. So no minus 1 curves on fibers. So on these guys here, p minus 1 of t. And so this is relatively minimal. And finally, I hope it's OK if I write here. I might want this vibration to have a section. So a guy, a morphism to, from B to Y, such that when you compose it, you get the, so a section, which is a morphism from B to Y, that when I compose with pi gives me the identity map inside B. Don't have place here. So that's what is an elliptic vibration on a surface Y. The surface Y can be for us, well, any surface. So let me give you one example, which is maybe the most down-to-earth one that we can think about, is the following. Consider 2 cubic curves, F and G, in the plane. And I assume, at least one of them to be smooth. And we can look at the following map, which goes from P2 to P1. And for each point, gives me F of that point, G of that point. This is a rational map. It's not defined where. Where these curves meet, no? Exactly where. So I have my 2 cubic curves. By Bézout, they meet in 9 points. They do not have to be all like that, different. Of course, they can be the same one, actually. But they meet in 9 points. And if we blow up these points, we get a surface now, Y, with a real morphism to P1. Such that the fibers are curves that satisfy, well, all the three here. So this is a very nice surface, but unfortunately, it doesn't let us yet make the bridge between these two subjects here, because this surface is a rational surface. So Y is a rational elliptic surface, because it is a because it is a blow up of the plane. And it turns out that all elliptic surfaces that are birational to P2, so that are like that, rational, they are gotten in that way over C. So this is giving you all of them. Very nice. So, but this doesn't tell us much about what we want to tackle in this talk. Let me try to make you the bridge here. So for so if I do take now a surface just like that, y, gotten in that way with a map to P1, and I consider a degree 2 map from another P1 to my base, and I do the fiber product of it. So I take, I have here pi, I have some phi. I take the fiber product over the bases. I get a surface here, which may be a smooth or not. It's gonna depend on where this is gonna be branched. But if everything is okay, so if it's not branched, so if the branch locus is reduced, then the blow up eventually of this surface gives me a surface X. And this surface is a K3 surface. And comes, moreover, with a vibration to P1. Ha! And if you want to think a little bit more now, just during this talk, you can try to see this surface that I got here, the K3, as a double cover of P2 branched over a degree 6. Who's going to be this degree 6 here? The two fibers where this branches. This is this is a degree 2 map from P1 to P1. It's going to be branched over 2 points. Above these 2 points, I have 2 fibers, which may be smooth or not. And so the union of these guys, when I go back to P2, gives me the sag stick there. So this is also another way to see this surface. Okay? So now, what is, so let me tell you before we go on, we spoke about an elliptic vibration. Let me tell you, why do we care about these things? So why are they important? So why do we care about these vibrations, these guys? Well, I can give you many reasons to care. One of them is that for all of us, it's much easier to work with curves than with surfaces. So easier to work with curves. I didn't make a picture of the surface, but if you want, we can make a very nice photo of it here. So you can imagine, you have to think of something like that. You have your surface, y, you have your curve B, okay? And for each point in B, I go back by my Mach pi, and what I get is a genus 1 curve here. Sometimes, as I said, they are not genus 1, they are something like that, rational curves. And so that's the kind of thing that I have. And if I have that my surface y is defined over a field k, I look at the generic point. And I have a curve here, which is a genus 1 curve. And such that the sections that I have there, which have to meet the fibers in a 1 point, which is a simple point in each of them, they give points here. So that's the picture you can have in mind if you want to look at that. So let's go back to why do we care. As you saw there, if you have such a thing, you have many, many curves inside of the surface. And it's much simpler to deal with them than to deal with the whole surface itself. So if you can find out things about these curves, you do find out things about the surface y above. I mean, that has them. So this is a clear reason to work with. Another reason to work with these guys is that for so one thing that you get, for example, so if you do a geometry, you get a lot of information about the Denon-Severi group of the surface. How? Well, this is given by the Schoede-Tate formula, this is Shiodatate, which tells you that this guy modulus some other guy, some group, some lattice. This is the Mordell-Weil group of the fibration. So you also get a lot of information about the curves there, about the divisors inside of the surface. Finally, okay, I don't care about geometry. I don't want to know about these guys. I want to know about number theory. So if you do arithmetic, you might care about those because you might use those for example, to prove that the rational points over your field that you like, say K, are Zariski dense over, so you might use them to prove, for example, potential density, which is not Zariski dense, but it is a Zariski dense over an extension of your field of the rational points. And this is a result by, who do use that as Bogomolov and Shinkel. So this is one reason to care about these things. There are many, many more that you can think of. So far I told you what is a K3, what is an elliptic fibration, and now we know that some K3s do have these vibrations because I just showed you one there. But it's not true that they do have always. So one observation is that in general, and by general I mean inside, if you pick a general K3 inside the moduli space, K3s do not admit elliptic vibrations. So it sounds like I am making something bad for myself when I say that. So do not admit elliptic vibrations. Not even the first type here. Well, but not not all is lost, because actually the ones that do admit, they are dense inside the moduli space of K3s. So it is a good reason to care for them and to try to get a little more about them. So why K3s? Why I don't take another surface to just worry about? So I worry about K3s. That's another remark, an observation. Because K3 surfaces, they are actually, K3s are the only class. So they form the only class that might admit more than one fibration, more than one elliptic fibration. Of course, which is not of product type. So I'm going to put here, not of product type. Of course, if you are thinking about these things, you say, oh, take the product of two curves, of two, U1 and E2 of genus 1, and you get two vibrations here. You can take things like that. I don't want to care about these things. So I want to care about K3s, and they are the only ones that might have several vibrations like that. And this is very interesting. Moreover, I didn't say the basis of the vibration. If you're talking about the rational one, it's clear that it has to be P1. If it's a K3, it has to be P1 as well. And this is essentially the fact that the, because of that, the H1 of the basis has to live inside here. So it has to be P1, the basis of the fibration. So that's where we start now. Our starting point is the fact that they can have many vibrations. And what I want to do is to find them, to describe them, to classify. So our goal in this talk, is to describe or to classify these vibrations. Uh, the elliptic vibrations. On, well, it's not easy to do for all K3s, on certain K3s. And now I have to tell you what certain means. So, well, first, I should tell you, I will be very vague here, just because of time. I cannot tell you precisely, I mean, what you have is that there are many ways to classify the vibrations inside, a surface. Some are more useful than others, but for one thing that you could do is to, well, which is the best thing to do, would be to describe the vibrations modulo the automorphisms of the surface. This is hard. This has been done by some people, but it's quite hard because this group can be very big, very large. So one thing that you can try to do is to give classes of curves that will give you these vibrations. And this is much more simple, actually. This is, I mean, easy, which would be, for the K3 surface, find classes of curves F inside of the surface such that F squared is equal to 0. This is enough to give you an elliptic vibration. You prove that just by showing that this implies that the genus of F is 1. So if you have an effective curve to start with, that the genus is 1, and then you use Riemann-Hoch to show that this has dimension, projective dimension, at least 1, so that this varies. So this thing is enough, but it doesn't give you a good feeling about really what these curves are. It doesn't tell you much. So we want to have a compromise. This is too hard. This is not so nice. So what we are going to do, essentially, is we are going to describe which kind of reducible fibers can have the vibration. So we are going to describe the reducible fibers of the vibrations. This is what we are going to be doing, which is more than that, but it's somehow less than that. And sometimes we get this, but not always. So that's what we want to do. And let me tell you what certain means. So for me, a certain will mean precisely that my K3 is this kind. So this is not so bad. So certain means that my K3 is a double cover of a rational elliptic surface. Okay, this sounds not so much nice, because the surfaces are maybe not so many, but actually they are. So, these K3 surfaces, they will have a Picard number at least 10, which means they can still fill out a big strata of the moduli space. The moduli space of our K3s, it's 19. So it has a dimension 19, and those have their, they have Picard number at least 10, so they can still occupy a place there. But moreover, I have a second way of describing them, which maybe makes them nicer to you, which is the following. You could look at these surfaces, say I want to study K3 surfaces X together with a non-symplectic involution iota, such that iota has some prescribed fixed locus. So such that fixed iota is given by curves of genus at most 1. And again, this is a lot of K3s, as it was before, because, so let me just tell you what is a non-symplectic involution. So a non-symplectic involution is an involution, so it is an automorphism of order 2, that, moreover, does not fix the symplectic, does not fix omega x, the period of x. So that's what happens. Where this is the period, the guy who generates H20X, which is the symplectic structure of my surface, X, I mean, yeah, there. You can get a lot from this guy here. So that's the surfaces we care. So I could have started by not saying anything about those, which is what I did so far in my talks, just saying that I care about these surfaces here, and then finally show you that they are always of this kind that I said here. So, but why do we want to do that? So why are those certain surfaces special? And so they're special for the following reason. Well, what we normally like to do when we're doing like mathematics, I think, in general, is to take something that we don't know how to deal because it's way too hard and make it simpler. And that's what I've been trying to do, I mean, through these years. Now I've been trying to take something that I don't know a lot about, which would be my surface that lies here on top, and get back, try to get like a map or some kind of a connection from this surface, which is hard, to something which is very simple. So that's like the reason why we chose to care about those. So the advantage of that is that we are able to transfer a problem, the classification problem, from the K3. Classification, I mean, of the vibration, SNA, to a much simpler surface, which is a rational surface, which everybody knows. To a rational surface, it's very simple to deal with. It's a blow up of the plane. So that's why it is a nice thing to do. So what do we do finally then? So what we did, our method, so this is essentially our method, I could say. And the thing is that, so I say, K3s are the only ones that can have many vibrations. So it comes for free that this surface here can only have one, the one that I blew up the plane. And you see the vibration. It's given by combinations of my curves F and G. Now you have something of the form TF plus UG, where TU is in P1. Essentially, they look at something like that. And what we want to do then is to see what a vibration here could give me here. So one thing is that we get one vibration for free inside of my surface X, namely this one transfers to a vibration here. So I get one for free inside of my K3 surface, which is very well known from the fact that, I do a degree 2 map above each fiber that I have here. I have 2 fibers here, but for the place where this is branched, ramified. Then I have something odd happening. For one fiber, I have 1. And if it was something like a node, I actually have this process that I have to blow up. And what I get here is something like that, the banana curve. But this one I know a lot about. What other can I have? So what else can I have? Well, I know that they are not genus 1 vibrations here, but a simple, so what do they look like? Do the vibrations on the K3 look like when I push them down to Y? So in Y, the rational surface. So as I said, one of them is for free, is that one. The other thing that I could do, I could take the following. I could take conics, more general, conic bundles. And by that, so for me, a conic bundle will be a rational curve such that So I have this map, né, from P1 to P1, and it's a rational curve that intersects the anticanonical, so the fibers of Y in two points, therefore the name, conic. And they are, so I want something that is base point free, and I want, and they have genus equal to zero also, will follow from these two here. So if I take curves like that, so they are P1s essentially inside Y, and I look at what they give here, you apply, for example, a Hurwitz formula, you get something of genus 1. And so what you get here, it's curves that look like that. And these curves, so if I want a bundle, so I really have something that varies. So I can put a T here. And these curves have genus 1. And they lie inside my K3. And they give a vibration, which is base point free and everything else. So I do get more vibrations inside my surface, K3, from conic bundles inside the surface Y, the rational one. OK, the problem, or the nice thing, is that they are not all of them. And therefore, the title of my talk maybe should not have been conic bundles, but more generally, linear systems inside the rational. So, yeah, so the rational surface. So the problem, or the nice thing that happens, is that these guys are not all of them. So the elliptic vibrations on my surface on my surface X, they have other shapes, other faces. So this gives me a conic bundle here, gives me an elliptic vibration on the K3. No. And the problem, what are the others? No. Or are there other elliptic vibrations? That is what we want to describe. We know that there are those. So I described you already essentially two types of vibrations, namely the ones that come from the vibration that I had on my surface Y. So I had Y directional over P1. Now I had to blow up maybe something. It's still a rational surface. This was the blow up of the singular locus of the branch locus. And then I have a K3 here, lying here. And what I told you is that, well, vibrations that are genus 1 vibrations here, so the one kind that I have, give something here. Conic bundles here give something here. And I am hiding something from you, which is the fact that when I have to blow up the singular locus of this degree 2 map here, I get a surface which it has more space for having more vibrations, and they are not minimal. So this surface Y might have more genus 1 vibrations, but they are not minimal on the second sense that I wrote when I defined these vibrations. So, and these will also give vibrations here. So far we have two types, either they come from conic bundles, or they come from these genus 1 families, which we have control because they are, I mean, essentially, after all, curves in P2 that pass through the points that I had to blow up. So genus 1 in, I'm going to put Y tilde, because it really represents the fact that I can have more than one. But it still does not answer what I posed here. And the fact is that to answer that, I have to get a little more about the effect of iota, my non-symplectic involution. Ah, nobody asked me, where is the non-symplectic involution? I mean, which involution is that? So this involution here, when I look at the double cover, is what? The double cover involution. It is the deck involution. That's what I mean here. It's exactly that. So I want to know the effect of this involution on the elliptic vibration, so on the fibers of elliptic vibrations on X. And this is going to help me to understand what more can I have here. This is going to help me to fill in this table of what will they look like when I go to my surface Y, the rational one. And it's exactly that. So let's keep an eye on here. So what can it do? Can do the following. Well, the involution is there. It sees the fiber, and it does nothing to it. Does nothing means that it does something in the fiber, but it doesn't switch it to like a, yeah, so it fixes the fiber. So iota of a fiber, Ft is a fiber, is equal to Ft. This doesn't mean that it doesn't mess there inside the curve Ft, but this is something that it could do. What it can also do, well, it's a degree, so yeah, so it's a degree 2 map. So it can take a fiber for my vibration to another fiber and back. So it takes the fibers and switches them around, one to the other to the one. I apply again, I go back to my curve. This is something which is allowed. No? And I'm going to show you that these guys here, the curves that are like that, they are going to give you, so we show that they give conic bundles. And the curves that are like that give exactly this genus 1 pencils. But you must be wondering, is this all that it can do? I mean, you said my K3 can have many genus 1 curves inside of it. So it can very well be that I take the fiber and I take to something else, which is another curve of genus 1. From what I said to you, once you have a curve of genus 1 on your K3, you have an elliptic vibration inside of it, as long as it is an F class, an effective class, actually. But so it can take a curve Ft to a curve G, also T. It's going to vary with T. But it has nothing to do with the vibration. And that's the missing thing here. So we want, so what we have to do now to really get what happens to the vibrations is to see what these things are. And so we are going to walk a little bit around that. I need my notes to remember the intersection of these things. But these things are going to give, actually, non-complete linear systems on Y, on the rational surface Y. So they are going to lie inside a much bigger linear system, which is, which is nice, complete, has a smooth member, and so on. And they are going to be a one-dimensional thing inside this big system. And that's what they are going to be. So let's get why does this happen. Let's understand so why. So the first theorem, then. So I'm going to call a vibration. I'm going to give names. This is type A, this is type B, and this is type C. And the first thing we showed, no? Is that, so if I have X be a K3 surface, with a non-symplectic involution iota, or I can simply say, well, that fixes something, so that is a double cover of a rational elliptic surface. So with prescribed fixed locus, I really want to be vague here. Prescribed fix iota. then vibrations of type. So I'm going to show what I just wrote here are induced means they are pullbacks of conic bundles. So why is X quotient by iota? And then, I mean, it's a, yeah, so you have to take it smooth. So maybe I have to take a tilde on top. Vibrations of type B, they are induced by genus 1 pencils on Y tilde. Well, maybe here I really, X tilde quotient by iota. And finally, vibrations of type C, they are induced by non-complete linear systems on Y. It's really Y here. I can really go down, and it's still going to be a non-complete mess. So let's have an idea of why this holds. So I just said to you that this is the case. Let me give you an idea of why. So say that I have iota, so idea of the proof. OK, say that I have my iota, and it fixes the fiber. This means, actually, in the end of the day, that iota restricted to a fiber has to act as a non-symplectic, so iota is a non-symplectic involution. Non-symplectic involution on the fiber. Well, this has a little thing to prove here, but believe me, that's what happens. So I have my non-symplectic involution inside my fiber. Remember, what are the fibers? They are elliptic curves. What are these involutions on the elliptic curves? Well, they are actually the hyperelliptic involution, eventually composed with some translation. Now, that's what they look like. Well, I'm going to suppose for a simplicity that it's just that, but it really doesn't matter here. So the hyperelliptic involution, which means that it has four fixed points. No? So what I have in the end of the day, when I take my map, let's give names to things, from X to Y, my quotient map, psi, psi of my curve FT is going to be, meeting the branch locus in four points. Remember, the branch locus is the fixed locus of iota. So it meets the branch locus in four points, which means I'm going to call this dt. I have a 2-to-1 map from ft, from a fiber upstairs to dt, 2-to-1. Which is ramified in four points. This is an elliptic curve. This means this is a genus zero curve. So this has to be, so this is Horvitz. And a calculation will show you that actually, so it meets the fixed locus, so the branch locus of this base change map. The branch locus is two elliptic curves, well, which can actually be singular, but it does meet this guy in four points. And actually, the canonical, the anti-canonical divisor of my surface Y is actually the same as a fiber, which now I'm going to call E, which is a fiber of pi. Now? So if I look at what E gives on UI and X, now this guy is gonna be meeting, so this DT meets some two curves, EY1, EY2, in 4, which means that DT, well, they are actually the same modulo, well, linear or a numerical, modulo numerical equivalence. So this is 4, and this means that DT is 2, as I wanted. They are conic bundles. I had described to you what they are here. That's exactly what I get. OK. The other case, what I get. So we're happy with case A, type A. Type B, what I have is that if I look at C of FT, so I have a curve again, DT. So now I am looking at type B. I have a curve DT. And above the curve DT, what do I have? FT and its friend, FT prime. So I have 2 genus 1 curves above this DT, which, I mean, after, so I have my DT. This is a degree 2 map. And I have FT and FT prime. So this means, in the end of the day, that DT, it has to be itself a genus 1 curve. And then we come to type. I mean, we can show also that it will have to intersect the canonical, minus k, y. It will intersect as with 0. So it is a base point free thing, and I have dt minus ky tilde is 0. Okay, and then finally type C. Well, type C is ugly, but it's nice because it tells us a lot about, well, the surface itself. And before I talk about type C, since I think that my time is going short, let me tell you that type C does not always have to be, we do not always have type C. There are some ways to get rid of it. So if you want to classify K3, so all the vibrations, and you don't want to have trouble with type C, it is enough for once to suppose. So once that you can suppose to get rid of type C, you can suppose. So a iota certainly gives you something inside the Neron Severi of X, no? With the classes of the curves. And you can suppose that this acts as the identity. It's a nice hypothesis. It's fair. But it is restrictive on the surface. But it says a lot about this kind of guy here. It has a very specific face. It will have to be a lattice of a very special form. But still, there are plenty of those. You have a lot of those. But this will already say a lot about the surface Y, actually. So if, for example, you have that Y, that the branch map, so that the C from X to Y has no reducible fibers outside of the branch, then you can assure that this happens, for example. It's a strong hypothesis, because then you have just nodes on the surface or cusps, and then just the branch has to have all the bad locus of the fibration. But you can have this happening, and then there is no type C. But we want to deal with all, I mean, with them all. And then type C, what you would have to have is that you have iota of FT some GT. And therefore, since they are not the same vibration, they meet in some points. And what you can do is I want to look at ft plus gt, this linear system here, inside of my surface x, the k3. And this guy here, so you have that ft plus gt squared. Since the squares are 0, this is 2m. Okay? So you use probably a Riemann-Hoare to show that this gives you an m plus 1 dimensional system. And you can also use the fact that they are both equal to 0 to show that this is base point free. And the idea then is to try to look at what this would give to me inside my surface y, the rational. And what we have showed is that this big system is going to give me a fat system whose general member has actually genus 1. So I'm going to call C for now. And the curves that I'm looking for are some curves dt that lie inside this nice linear system. These dt are, again, the psi of Fts, okay? And they lie inside this nice system of curves of genus 1. And each of these curves, if you remember, so you have these curves, they meet Ft and Gt in m points. Now, that's what I wrote here. These curves Ct, they meet the branch locus in m points, the ramification locus in m points, and we managed to show actually that this m has to be actually even. And therefore, the very nice thing is that now we just managed to see this curve Ct, or dt, as a generalization of these guys here. Because these guys here would be a case when this m is actually 0. We managed to see this arising as, and this is very, very cool. This is something we saw like recently, that these things here are not so crazy as you might think. It's not any non-complete system on the surface. They are very special. They are, I mean, they do actually, they are very connected to these guys. And, I mean, if you see the curve here, this is very singular, but this is a smooth curve of genus 1. So, to finish, I think I'm really already over, I can tell you, what can we do with that? So we can do a lot of things. One thing that we can do now is to really list all the vibrations on a K3, and we did that, actually, in another, in another paper that is going to come soon. We just worked out all that we did here, which is very general, to get a list of the vibrations. And this is something that we still don't know for many K3s. So we get a list of the vibrations for some K3s, for example, where iota fixes a curve of genus 1, and K rational curves, where K can be anything from 1 to 9. And so this is something that you can use it for. I really hope that we can use this kind of method to get a lot of information about the K3 surface. So I'm going to stop here. Sorry.